Can I bring you then to the question of rent, given all of that, given the fact that that set of circumstances resulted in a remedy in Catter 1 from this court, given the fact that no court has yet internationally accepted that there is a duty to protect, how do we get to the remedy that was imposed by the Court of Appeal and the trial court in the absence of such a duty? What's the link then that entitles a court to determine that is a proper remedy, either under the Charter or under a judicial review?
Well, of course, I went off for a while about this duty to protect under international law and whether it arises under these circumstances. But our primary position has always been that simply participating in this process was a violation of Section 7, indeed we say Section 12, and that the duty, quote unquote, the duty to protect can simply be imposed as a remedy under Section 24(1) in the second half of the analysis.
But that's discretionary. That's not a mandatory duty. The way you've been putting it is that there's no other option, that when you've got these circumstances, the only thing that the government can do is to ask for his repatriation. Is that your position?
Well, that's what we were spending, as I say, that was one potential approach to our argument, and that's what we've been saying. But what I've also said is, even if you disagree with me on that point, it can be imposed as a remedy under Section 24(1), and it's a discretionary remedy, and the judge in this case exercised his discretion in favor of granting that remedy. And he considered all the facts that are relative to this case, and he decided, I'm going to impose, now you could say, is that a duty? Well, perhaps it's just a duty to comply with the court's order, which granted a particular remedy under Section 24(1). So, to be clear, let's assume for the sake of argument there is no positive duty under Section 7. There may not be. If there isn't, we say, fine, certainly one can be ordered as a remedy under Section 24(1). Courts require government to take positive steps as a 24(1) remedy all the time.
Can I ask you this, though? I mean, I think what's bothering some of us is the link between the alleged complicity that you've been discussing and this particular remedy of asking for repatriation. One usually expects remedies to remedy the very thing that's gone wrong. So here you're saying it's this participation in the interview process, knowing that there was torture. Usually you'd expect the remedy to going to fix that up. At this point, there's no more recent evidence of torture or complicity. How is demanding or ordering repatriation now going to fix that in the past? He has suffered. He suffered greatly, no doubt, with great consequences. But how can we fix that particular suffering by bringing him back to Canada?
Well, it's a restitutionary remedy. It's something that's going to provide him with a benefit in exchange for the violation that's occurred. And it's going to bring an end to the violations which are ongoing.
Well, then when you get into the second part of that, then you're into the logic of an ongoing duty to, there's some continuing breach here that is going on, which is, I know, part of your case too. But insofar as you're just relying on this complicity argument, it seems to me you do face a problem linking it, because generally remedies haven't been just given at large, whether it be in tort law or any other kind of law. They have to somehow be responsive. At least that's my understanding as a lawyer.
Well, you would probably
to
know.
To the very breach. Well, I don't know. Perhaps you can enlighten me. But if you gave me some cases where remedies have been applied in this very broad, even restitution, I don't think has gone so far as to say there doesn't have to be a logical link. But perhaps you have authority.
Well, obviously, this is a unique case. And our submission is that this remedy is responsive to the violations, because it is a remedy which Canada can do, through which Canada can attempt to mitigate the harm that has caused, and potentially to bring an end to the ongoing detention. You'll recall at the outset of my submissions, I referred to the fact that diplomatic efforts are very much a part of the process that is now going on to try to deal with everyone in Guantanamo. And many countries are making these requests, some aren't. And under this unique circumstance, it's our submission that this type of request is just and appropriate for the purposes of Section 24.1. And it's responsive to the fact that this is someone who has been held without any kind of legal process for more than 7 years, since he was a child, and since Canada has participated in that unlawful detention regime all this time. When it comes to the ongoing violations that are still going, Mr. Justice LaBelle mentioned one of them, I think, and that is the ongoing delay that is going on here. Mr. Cotter still has really no access to any kind of legal process. We submit this is a shocking and unacceptable delay on the part of that foreign justice system. And to be clear, I mean, we do not suggest, of course, that this remedy will definitely, or this request, would definitely be agreed to by the United States. The United States may say no, or they may impose some conditions that Canada simply can't meet. But it's our submission that given what Canada has done to this point, given Canada's complicity in this process, this remedy, this request, is something that they can do to try to mitigate the situation and to try to lessen the harm that the respondent continues to experience.
Could I take you back
that
to
we have. So, go ahead.
Could I take you back to Suresh for a moment? Is it part of your case that there's sufficient causal connection between the refusal to seek repatriation and the mistreatment that the principals of Suresh are engaged?
No, the mistreatment is not the physical abuse. When you say mistreatment, the torture and so forth is not continuing to this point in time. Now, we certainly think that the request should have been made a long time ago, but there was no explicit demand for this type of request back in 2004. But to be clear, I do say that the link in Suresh is met in this case. It's a different type of situation. It is based on Canada's complicity in that process, which I've just referred to, and in particular in the Special Rapporteur's report. Just on that note, I would like to emphasize that...
So I'm very clear. You're saying that the absent the complicity, the simple failure to make the request, is not analogous to the failure to seek guarantees that capital punishment won't be imposed as in Burns.
I'm saying it's analogous, but what the court seemed to say in Suresh is that at least where Canada turning over the prisoner to the foreign country is a necessary precondition to the infliction of the torture, that will certainly constitute a violation of Section 7. Now, that is not the case here. Canada did not turn over Mr. Cotter to Guantanamo, but they went down and participated in the abuse that happened. Imagine if in Suresh, the Canadian government had actually gone over to the foreign country and participated in the torture of Mr. Suresh. It's our submission that it becomes a much easier case. It's not a more difficult case. And whether it would have happened anyway or not, the fact that Canada went out there and participated in that abuse, it provides a stronger case for a Section 7 violation in our submission.
Can I just